You know, there's Bible verse I think about sometimes. Many times. It goes, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me."
Now, I myself may not be a very religious person, but that scene alone is enough to get you in the feels if you have seen the movie multiple times or for the first time. And as somebody who has seen the movie Fury many, many times, I can say with my chest that this film is not only one of the best war movies ever made, but it is simply a masterpiece. I wanted to make this video on this day, especially since it is the 8-year anniversary since it first released in theaters on October 15th, 2014. I remember seeing this movie for the first time in an AMC theater with my brother, my dad, and a close friend of mine. And if I remember correctly, this was, I think, the first R-rated film I saw in theaters. The second was The Revenant in 2015, a year later. But in my opinion, I don't think I could have picked a better R-rated film to see as a first-time theater experience than this. I remember being so taken aback by it, and everyone loved their experience, who I was with. It only took me a couple of years later to really sit down with this movie and give it a couple of rewatches to truly see the greatness that this... When we think of great war movies, we think of films like Saving Private Ryan, which to some is the best war film ever made. Films like Hacksaw Ridge, which some would consider to be one of the best modern war films and stories told on film. Or even a film like 1917, which to this day is, in my opinion, not only the best war film ever made, but my favorite war film and my favorite film of that year when it came out in 2019. These are all films that resonate so well with that genre, and I think that Fury should absolutely be up there with that debate of what is the best war film or what is one of the best war films ever. Because as it stands, with my opinion, I would easily say that it is the most underrated for that purpose and that thought. You don't really see a lot of people talk about this movie and how it paints a picture of what World War II really looked like with its gritty and scary aspect. To this day, I think this movie really goes harder to show you the side effects of what a war can do to a person and how it changes different people over time while also showing you the horrifying aspects of it from the action and the imagery it displays of violence and death. And you'll notice here that I am going to be playing some music from a game called Call of Duty World at War, which also just happens to be a game set in the World War II era in the Call of Duty franchise, and I am playing in the background the main menu music, which to this day, I think is one of the best examples of music related to a time period ever created. It is scary, it's horrifying, and it gives you the chills. And I think it's the perfect piece of music to use in the background of this video to exemplify this movie. And don't get me wrong, I've seen the complaints that have been levied at this film from a continuity perspective and how it inconsistently treats the aspects of this type of warfare. But to me, when I watch this film, I understand that a lot of it needs to be dramatized for the viewer to really shake in what is happening on screen. If this film was the most accurate war film ever made, I don't think it would leave the same feeling that I had watching it so many times with its inaccuracies. I guarantee you there is at least something or multiple things that are inconsistent about almost every war film ever, so I don't think that criticism should be as high on people's minds when looking at this movie. I would also like to say that as somebody who has grown up watching the History Channel and seeing many different episodes of shows feature tanks, I've always wanted to have seen a war movie tackle the tank warfare aspect of a war. To this day, as far as I'm aware, this is the only movie ever that has done that, and I truly feel it nailed every aspect of it on the head. Being inside the claustrophobic space of this tank, following our main characters through every step of the way, just brings for so much tension and conflict, which also brews five unbelievably great character arcs, even if not all of them get the ample amount of time they need. And to speak on those characters and who portrays them, let's now talk about the people behind the camera. The film stars Brad Pitt as War Daddy, John Bernthal as Grady, Michael Peña as Gordo, Shia LaBeouf as Bible, and Logan Lerman as Norman, or War Machine as he goes by at the end of the film, who is the new kid who gets introduced to our main crew. You also get some supporting roles from actors like Scott Eastwood and Jason Isaacs, who, while they don't get a lot of screen time, you can very much understand what their roles are in the war by just watching them and their scenes. The film is directed by David Ayer, who has helmed films such as End of Watch, which is another favorite film of mine, The First Suicide Squad from 2016, which to this day is not his fault for why a lot of people didn't like it, Bright, the Netflix film starring Will Smith and Joel Edgerton, and then his most famous film to a lot of people in Training Day with Denzel Washington and Ethan Hawke. He's also written films such as U-571, the original Fast and the Furious movie, SWAT, and just about every single other one of the films that he has also directed. So immediately, you have a very experienced filmmaker involved in this movie, and to this day, I really liked a lot of his films that he has made. I would even conjure the opinion that he is an underrated filmmaker himself that doesn't get enough credit for making entertaining films, and ones that sit with you for a long time. And when we look at a movie like Fury, I think you have maybe his best work out of all his filmography. I know some will say End of Watch is his best, but for me, Fury beats it out by a mile and more. And so when you have all those people behind the camera, what is it that makes this movie truly a masterpiece? Just to speak on the technical aspects of this movie to start, I want to give a massive shout out to the team of people who said to make this movie as practical as possible, because I don't know if this movie would have been as entertaining to watch if it was just all CG and barely anything was practical. So much of this movie uses practical sets, locations, guns, and even the vehicles are all practical, including the tanks. And to be fair, I'm not saying that there isn't any CG at all in the movie. There's clearly some that is put into the movie, but it is so hard to see you can barely even notice. The tank fight that takes place in the middle to end portion of the film features all real tanks, including the German Tiger that fights the three Shermans. They went into a real-life museum and pulled out the only remaining Tiger that exists in the world and put it in this movie for use. That was a genius idea, and whoever came up with it deserves every amount of praise possible. And to end off this segment, talking on the technical side, again, I want to praise the practicality of it all, because when you see our characters go through the mud and dirt and the grime and see how dirty they are from everything they are doing, it just brings you into the film so much more. And they aren't just dirty physically from walking around in the mud, but they are also dirty psychologically in all their minds, which is where I want to transition to next in our characters. Our five main boys that we follow in the Fury tank to this day, I think, is one of the best ensemble casts that you could have put together to feed off each other, from their chemistry with each other to even the times when they had conflict that shows who they truly are in this war. Each one of these individuals is a battered and scarred human being. And even for the kid himself, Logan Lerman, who plays Norman, you can see the transition of who he becomes by the end of the film, from starting out as this kid who didn't want to be there, to a killer who embraced the side of what the other four had been doing for so many years in the war. And the film even does its job to tell you that the whole crew, minus Norman, had been together for practically the entirety of the war, going through even the African theater at the beginning of World War II. They've seen it all, they've been through it all, and they've done it all. And this film does such a great job to just show you why it's affected them so much. And speaking of the guy who is probably affected the most because of his status in the crew as the leader, Brad Pitt is unbelievably incredible in this movie as War Daddy. I honestly don't know if I could have picked a better guy to play this character. I've seen enough Brad Pitt movies to know that not only is he just one of the best actors to ever live, but even when the guy is not saying anything in a movie, you feel the emotion and the acting that he brings to it. The scene at the very beginning of the movie where he walks away from his crew after making it back to camp and has to give himself a minute to just reflect on everything he's been through is a perfect example in film for how you have to show and not tell. Just by watching him almost crumble at the thought of what he had just been through, it is enough to show you who he is as a person. A man who is truly affected by PTSD and everything that he has done in this war. A man who knows he can't show any of his crew that side or else they will lose their faith in him. Even when he opens up to Norman at the end of the film after the final battle, you see it in him that he's always felt this way, and that when he opens up to Norman of all people, he's free to feel those emotions that he couldn't show the rest of the crew. I would highly give a lot of notion to the thought that War Daddy might just be one of the best characters in a war film ever for those reasons I just listed out. He's a scarred character who goes through so much to the point where he finishes his character arc in the most badass fashion, as he fights to defend his crew and anyone else in the US Army who would have come through Germany and sacrificing himself for them in the process. And we aren't even done yet, because I still want to talk about the rest of the crew, who are also incredibly well played by the amount of actors they got to play them. Shia LaBeouf as the character Bible and the gunner of the tank, I think does so much to this movie from a faith perspective that he is the backbone of keeping these guys stable and in their peace of mind by giving Bible verses, which usually tend to be in the scenes that calm everyone down or are before or after a fight scene takes place. I am not here to comment on anything that is happening in real life with the actor and his personal life, but I am not going to sit here and deny that Shia LaBeouf is an incredible actor who gives an amazing performance here, and to some might have given the best performance in the entire film. Next up, you have John Bernthal as Grady, and the loader of the tank, who, if you've seen the movie or have not, he is the guy who plays the rough one of the bunch and really doesn't care what anybody else says about him or thinks about him and just does a lot of heinous things. The entirety of the dinner scene between the two German girls and the crew is still one of the most uncomfortable scenes in the movie from a character perspective, showing you who he truly is as a person. He will do anything to make himself look like a worse person than who he already was before. Again, we are talking about a very scarred individual who he himself even recognized when talking to Norman near the end of the film that he understands he's a bad person, which again does so much to develop his character. He's somebody who I think knows what he's done, and at the end of the film doesn't want to set a much more bad example for a kid like Norman, who he admits to saying is a good man. And oh, and of course, we can't forget, John Bernthal plays this character incredibly well, and to this day, I do hope that this man gets the recognition he deserves to where he might win an Oscar, because I know it's going to eventually come. Up next is Michael Peña as Gordo, who is the driver of the tank. Very, very good performance here from Michael, who is, to this day, I think one of the more underrated actors working who doesn't get enough work. I recently just saw him in the first time watch of 30 Minutes or Less, and he is hilarious in that movie. His character, I feel, to a lot of people, is going to be one who doesn't get talked about a lot, because some would say he's the one that is in the back of the whole group. You don't really get one singular scene that is between him and any one character. It's mainly him with the entirety of the crew for the most of the movie, which honestly I feel he could have used his own scene to give him more of a character arc, not to say that he doesn't have one. But with everything I just said, again, this is not to take away from his performance or the character itself. It is still a really good character. And finally, we have reached the last man of the crew, the newbie, Logan Lerman, or Norman, aka War Machine as he goes by in the movie, who is brought into the crew since they just lost their front gunner in a previous battle. To this day, I think Logan Lerman is one of the better young actors working today who is not in enough movies or shows for people to truly recognize him for who he is as a great young actor. This is a character who goes from being a scared and worried kid who, as he says, started as a typist to now out here gunning down German soldiers. He gets put through the ringer by every single character throughout this movie, and I really think that is how he becomes who he becomes at the end, as just this battered individual who in the span of a couple of days becomes an entirely new person who you could say turned into one of them who became what they did over the span of a couple of years. It just goes to show what war can do to a person. Bible himself even told Norman at the beginning of the film this same exact thing.
Wait until you see.
See what?
What a man can do to another man.
It's a very well-written line to just show you the progression of all these people and what they go through in the span of a couple of days till the final battle. And to speak on the writing a little bit, I'm not here to say that this is one of the most masterfully written films ever, but when we talk about the progression of a story between our characters and where they go, I think it is such a simple plot that gives you enough to leave feeling cold and empty. Hey, it really is a simple movie, and I think that's one of the biggest reasons why I love it so much. There's no overarching story here that you have to follow and understand. It's just a simple story about a tank crew who are in the final days and months of the war just doing a living. I mean, listen, they even say it themselves.
Best job ever.
Best job ever.
Best job ever.
Best job ever.
Now, to finish off this video, I do want to speak on the final battle and how the film ends, because this is where the movie shows not just all of its cards from an action standpoint, but also the emotional impact of what happens to our characters. Of course, I would hope that most of the people who see this video have seen the film by now since it is 8 years old, so I will talk spoilers here. After getting themselves in a bit of a tight spot from a landmine that crippled the tank, they are stuck to fight off an entire SS battalion of Nazi soldiers who are on their way to cripple a supply line. War Daddy and the rest of the crew decide to stay and hold their ground, and what commences is one of my favorite action sequences of all time in any movie. I love how this sequence, which holds the final 20 to 30 minutes, never once cuts away to anything else going on. It never gives you a moment to breathe, and it never stops feeding you the tension of the situation in which our crew are in, facing off against this battalion. They are clearly at the disadvantage, but they use with what little they have to kill and stop as many Germans as they possibly can, which is something that I love because it feels like a very low underdog story. At points when they run out of what they have to then put themselves at an even more higher risk just to try and get a footing in the battle, and sadly that would come with consequences. Grady is the first to fall as he takes a Panzerfaust shot directly through his body, killing him instantly. Such a heartbreaking scene, and even then, they know they can't stop because they are still in the fight. It doesn't stop after that as Gorder takes his own life to protect his crew from a grenade that he pulled the pin on after being shot. Bible is also then the next to go as he is in the blink of an eye, quite literally, no pun intended, taken out by a German sniper while trying to give War Daddy the grenades they have. And then instantly, the same sniper has his eyes on War Daddy and takes the shots, putting him down each and every time he lands a blow. This scene is heartbreaking beyond words because he is maybe the one guy out of the entire crew that you didn't want to lose. The one who was leading them all, the one who was sticking them together with what glue he had, and the one who defined what it means to be a badass hero. This is the scene once after being shot that I alluded to earlier, where he breaks down in front of Norman and showing his true self that he never wanted to show the rest of his crew. He is a scared man and somebody who doesn't want to die, but in that instance, knew he did everything he could. In their final moments, as the Germans surround the tank, he tells Norman to escape as they drop the grenades in, thus ending his life. We then see Norman at the hands of a German soldier who subsequently is also a kid, and I feel like there is a lot of commentary here on how being a kid in war really can affect you as the German lets him go and Norman is safe from being captured. As the film comes to an end, we see that Norman is taken in by the US forces who seemingly managed to get past the rest of that battalion and is sent home after surviving the entirety of the battle. The imagery in this scene showing the reflection of the tank on the truck he's taken in as he's being taken away knowing that he is never going to see that ever again. The camera pans up to a sky shot over the tank and the carnage that it lay around with all the dead German soldiers beaten and killed by the crew of the Fury themselves. The end. Man, what a film. And what a way to end it off. In the end, no one made it out but Norman. The ones who lasted through it all in the end were the ones who fell and laid down their lives to fight. And right now, I'm going to present to you all an image that will make you get even more emotional than when you were before. If you all remember the crawl text at the beginning of the film, the very last one before the film opens talks about how it is April of 1945. For those who know their history, the war ended in the same year. And so if you put two and two together, with the way the film ends, it is even more heartbreaking knowing that the original crew started the war together and yet we're only 5 months away from going home. If they had managed to get past that battle, there's a good chance they might have been able to go home, but it didn't go the way that they thought it would. And I feel like for those who realized it, that is something that sits with them every time they watch the movie. It's a little detail that I'm sure a lot of people didn't notice, and I just wanted to present it here for those who didn't. For those who actually managed to stay for the credits as well, I think the credits here are very, very stylized, and I like what they did with it. It gives you the scary feeling from the music that it is inside of it. And speaking of music, this movie has a great score and soundtrack, one of which I think has resonated with me more than most other war films I've seen. 1917 for me is the best one, but this one is also very good. I may not have touched on every single plot point or aspect of the film, but I think I got enough in here to really prove my point from me personally why I think this film is a masterpiece and one of the best war films ever made. I hope for those who are watching this, who may not have seen the movie, that you watch it when you can immediately, and then for those who have seen the movie, you know exactly what I'm talking about with everything I've said so far. I have seen many reactions on YouTube to this movie as of recently, and it's good to see that some are finding it. And again, happy 8-year anniversary to this film. I don't know if there's going to be anyone who worked on the film, actor, director, producer, or just regular crew member that sees this video, but just know you made an amazing film. And that is all I will say about this movie today. I hope you all enjoyed this video, and drop a like and comment down below what your thoughts are. I would greatly appreciate it. It would help spread the video out for more to see. And if you are new to the channel and have not subscribed, be sure to hit that subscribe button to follow for more videos down the line. I hope everyone here has a fantastic day, and I will see you all in the next one.